Moments which precede death are likely to be filled with images of one's past. And so it was with me. The sinking ship was sucking me through the tiny orifice which is the exit from the world. During a brief interval of consciousness, a myriad of remembrances and reflections spun through my mind. I wanted to take with me as many memories as I could conjure and to review my misjudgments and mistakes.
John was standing on the side, and an older boy yelled up, "Are you afraid to come in?"
"Come on, John, jump, here."
That did it. John just jumped right in, even though he'd never been swimming in his life. He couldn't swim.
But he didn't care.
I think that was probably the beginning of that crazy daredevil, I'm just gonna have fun with all my friends, I don't care, I'd throw a caution to the wind.
This man dives into life. He dives into the moment, he dives into the experience, he dives into his relationships with people.
He's also one of these characters that tended to show up in the most unusual places and have the most wonderful experiences and friends and opportunities.
There was never a dull moment. There were hard moments and not so hard moments, but never dull.
John's mom planted the seeds in him. There's love out there. Expect it and find it.
I believe it was definitely the love of a woman like Katie that changed John Wells' life forever. The love that they carried and shared and showed others was phenomenal.
John was lucky, I must say. But you know why he was lucky? Because he made his own luck.
It was the journey for John and not the end point that he was looking for. It was that journey. John Weld was born in Hendersonville, North Carolina. Unfortunately, his father died not too long after his birth, when he was about 6 months old.
Although his father was in the insurance business, he never bought any life insurance. And so when he passed away, there was no money in the estate, and they were broke.
And my great-grandmother, having difficulty with finances and wanting to provide a father, met a man in Atlanta, Mr. Lewis, and they were married.
Mr. Lewis and I did not get along well. I was jealous of him, and we were always vying for mother's attention. He moved my mother, my sister Eleanor, and I to Birmingham, Alabama. We settled into an apartment on 13th Street, and in the building's basement, I met a man who became like a father to me. His name was Brown. Not Mr. Brown, or George Brown, or Ambrose Brown. He was just plain Brown.
Brown, look what I found.
Well, shut my mouth. Ain't that a find?
I think Brown was quite a great influence on John at a time when he needed a man to look up to.
I got a speculation. You was born with a call.
What's a call?
It's like a heavenly cap that some folks is wearing when they born. The Lord put it there to show him that the extra.
He saw something in John and wanted John to really know that he was
special,
that he had a special quality about him.
I think that was probably the first time John got the idea that, oh, maybe I can go places and do things.
After schooling and chores, I'd spend time with Brown, helping out with jobs around the building. During the summers, my mother packed me off to my aunt's home in North Carolina. Her husband, my Uncle Billy, was a doctor.
Uncle Billy was a classic country doctor. He'd have a horse and buggy, and John would go with him. John always marveled that he always treated white people and black people the same. There was no difference.
The black folks just the same as the white folks?
Well, John, you should always judge and respect a man on the basis of his character, not his color. You understand?
Yes, sir.
He was a great influence on his life. Yeah. Never spoke profanity, yeah. Never raised his temper. He was just a very good man.
Uncle Billy and Brown did more to build my psychic structure than any teachers I've known.
Well, tells us that he got his first job delivering papers. What's interesting about that is it reminds us of the primacy of newspapers in the time in which Weld was growing up. Newspapers were the media. I mean, radio was beginning, visual things like television were years away, and the world centered around newspapers. That's how you learned what happened.
I read sections of the Birmingham Age Herald each morning, and I enjoyed the poems submitted by readers. Each morning along my route, a big dog snarled at me, so I wrote my first poem about that dog. I rhymed bite with fright and hit with stick. It must have been awful, but the Age Herald printed it.
And he got the thrill, which is unlike any of seeing his name in print.
I spent my high school years at a military school in Tennessee, mainly to get me out of the house and away from my stepfather.
I have no life but this to lead it here. Nor any death, but last dispelled from there.
During the summers, I stayed at school and lived in a co-ed boarding house. One day, after visiting hours had ended, I found myself in the second floor room of a lovely young lady.
Emily Dickinson. It's your favorite, right?
I just feel so scandalous having you in my room.
We haven't done anything scandalous.
The landlady
yet.
That would come by at a certain time and knock on everybody's door to make sure you're in your rooms, because it was co-ed. You're not supposed to be in somebody else's room, especially if it was a female. John started hearing the landlord knocking on the doors.
Miss Lisa, open this door.
At least now it'll be worth the repercussions.
He's on the second story, so he's like, oh, I gotta get out of here.
I had no idea at the time that this embarrassing stunt was a harbinger of much riskier things to come. I started college at the Alabama Polytechnic Institute, which later became Auburn University, and enjoyed the writing program. But at the close of my first year, mother had sent a letter along with a check for $100. She explained that she was divorcing my stepfather. I felt sad for her, but I wouldn't miss Mr. Lewis. But this meant the end of my college days.
I'm sorry to push you out of the nest so soon, but I think it best you start seeing the world. You might go to Kansas City where your sister is living. Good luck and write to me often.
She had done all she could to get me started up life's ladder. My umbilical cord had been cut. Suddenly, I was alone.
My sense of John is he was pretty good at picking himself up and getting on with it.
He was in Atlanta with some friends of his. He was 17 years old, and Hollywood beckoned.
Where have you guys been?
I'm
waiting for an hour.
And so they got in a car, and I think they had $5 to their name, and headed cross country.
Los Angeles, here we come.
Although we four adventurers were without funds, we were not without resources. We had learned that one can cover a multitude of deficiencies with graciousness and good manners.
Keep rolling.
Back in those days, there was no central casting, so every movie studio had their own casting office, and so they would make the rounds to the various studios back then and try to get work as an extra, because an extra paid $7.50 per day, which was a lot of money back then.
Day after day, exuding charm to make friends, we went to rounds of these fantasy factories.
So you ever done any background work before?
No, sir, but I'm a fast learner. I pick up things real fast. And I love the movies, especially the cowboy pictures.
Ride horses.
Yes, sure can.
If you wanted to be in the film industry, you just have to show up at one of the studios and find out when they're gonna have a casting call. And there was a man at the gate that could tell you, yeah, there's gonna be one here tomorrow morning at 8:00.
It was difficult because they weren't the only ones out in Hollywood looking for work. A lot of other people were out there, so there was a lot of competition. Well, after a couple of weeks in Hollywood, you know, they couldn't find any extra work. And so his friends decided they'd had enough. And they headed back to Georgia and took the car. Left him a note saying, goodbye, we're out of here. So John was left out here by himself. You know, he's a very physical guy, very athletic. So he actually joined the swim team at the Ambassador Hotel and swam competitively for them. So while he was swimming for the Ambassador Hotel, he noticed that there was a call there for extras for a film, and they needed swimmers. And so they held the auditions at the Ambassador.
They were asking people, can you swim? First of all, can you swim? That's number one. Can you dive? Number two.
Yeah, you bet.
Be available this Monday. We're taking the whole unit out to Santa Cruz Island.
I'm hired? I am.
Great. You're gonna be featured in a big fantasy sequence. You'll need to come by the studio tomorrow to be fitted for your fish suit.
Sorry, a fish suit?
So Fox was sending the cast and crew to Santa Cruz Island. While they were there, there was a stunt that was coming up. Now mind you, John and his buddy were just background swimmers. But all of a sudden, there's this stunt that two stuntmen were supposed to jump off this cliff. It was like 135 feet. Back then, and even today, we calculate how much you're gonna get paid per stunt and the danger involved. I think back then it was $1 a foot for the first 25 feet, $5 a foot to the next 50 feet, and then 10 per foot after that, so on and so forth. So it turns out that the stunt was gonna cost $1,000. That's a lot of money back then.
Gotta cut the dive.
Rubbish, we're not cutting the dive. The dive is the scene. Look, just ask one of the extras. They look fit enough.
I'm not sure that's a good idea.
Oh, please. Gentlemen, would either of you care to make a little extra money today?
Yeah, sure.
Great. Horace here will fill you in. Good luck.
How's 60 bucks, Sam?
What do we gotta do?
Dive off that cliff into the cove. It's not very high.
Yeah, not high at all.
Great. Let's get you into place. We're losing daylight.
Sure you want to do that? It's pretty high.
Yeah, well, 60 bucks just made it a whole lot lower.
That was a lot of money. It was a lot of money back then. And he was young, I'm going to do a stunt. Absolutely, I'm on a movie set.
It was imperative that I do the dive. At that time in my life, I badly needed self-confidence and a proud heart. It was my first movie stunt. But in getting to the top of the cliff, a rock had dislodged and struck me on the head. The doctor took 3 stitches to my head, and after 2 shots of bourbon to calm my nausea, I set out again.
Hey, are you okay?
He's
fine, let's go again.
Stuntmen back then had to definitely have some kind of athletic ability, for sure. But more so than that, that crazy edge to them that they're just gonna do anything you ask them to do.
Here we go, walk all the way out.
I can relate.
A little fart, what's his name?
John Weld.
The big difference between stunts back in the early 2030s compared to today, number one is safety. Not just the safety precautions that go along within setting up, prepping a stunt, but also the equipment. And besides that, back then, there wasn't any training. You just did it.
He was taking a big risk because there was no regulation of any kind of sets in those days.
Okay, John, you're doing great. Keep going all the way to the end.
Looking down, I was dumbfounded by the distance to the water.
Here we go, right there.
So at 135 feet, when you're jumping in and you're diving head first, you can snap your neck. You could really do a lot of damage. That was a serious stunt, as a first stunt, especially.
Roll camera!
Rolling.
And action! Dive!
Look at him, he's scared.
You chicken. Come on, jump, jump.
I was astonished I was still alive. My back ached and blood streamed down my face as I swam out of the scene. My scalp needed 18 stitches.
You okay?
That was the first time that he really applied the confidence that he had from growing up and his ability to really assess and use his gifts and his talents to say, I'm here, what can I do? Oh, okay, I can do that. I can figure it out. He just had to look around and he literally, in a crazy way, just dove in and really embraced the situation as it presented itself.
Once that stunt happened, word got around Hollywood really quick. The offers really came in for him, so it really kind of catapulted his career at that point.
John worked with very famous stars, at which he would double for them as stunts, Charlie Chaplin, John Barrymore, Tom Mix.
He was doing high dives and riding horses, jumping on the top of trains, which is highly complex. Coming out of cars, flipping cars, turning cars over. He just went for it. The guy had a lot of gumption, man.
John was very handsome, well-mannered, and in great demand to accompany the women that were single to various social events. And so that got him into a lot of parties and a social crowd that he probably wouldn't otherwise get into.
Getting into parties got me into some wonderful situations and some that I should have avoided, mainly situations with women.
John Weld met Josephine Butterly while they were dancing at the Coconut Grove, and the two hit it off immediately.
I find you a most charming companion, Mr. Weld. I can't say when I've had a more wonderful time out.
The feeling is quite mutual, Miss Butterly.
He was very taken with her. She's telling him her sad tale of woe about how she was engaged to be married and her boyfriend jilted her.
I think you're feeling what I'm feeling. Am I right, John?
I believe I am, Miss Butterly.
She actually proposed to him and said,
let's get married.
He was very impetuous and thought,
sure, why not, let's.
And so he did.
So John had told her she was 23, he actually was 19, and he had no money. So that marriage did not last long.
Give me one second, I promise.
The whole affair ended about as fast as it had begun. I had no more business marrying Josephine than I had going to the moon. It was utterly reckless of me to say that I would, but I did. But for me, marrying a girl I hardly knew was in character. I was rescuing a lady in distress, but I didn't learn my lesson well. In no time at all, I was involved with another eager lady, Elizabeth Buemiller.
When she took John over to introduce him to his mother, they hit it off, but then her mother advised she was going to Europe.
Bon voyage.
Thank you, Mr. Wells.
How long will you be gone?
About 6 months. I asked Betty to go with me, but she said she'd rather stay here with you.
Oh, I'm flattered.
I don't want to leave her alone.
John said, well, I'll watch out for her. And her mother said,
that's what worries me. I don't want you two living together. Why don't you get married?
And John was game for it again.
What do you say, you game? Are you willing to marry a pauper?
Of course.
He always wanted a home and a loving woman and so forth, so they got married.
Cheers.
And the same thing happened there. They had no funds, began to argue.
John, we needed the money.
Betty became pregnant. There were doctor bills.
$20.
That's not the point. You should have asked me first.
Betty earned $20 posing for a photographer, and this caused our first serious quarrel.
I'll find a job, Betty.
I'd been brought up to consider it degrading for a man for his wife to work, and her doing so pointed up my failure to provide.
When he got home one night, his wife wasn't there and found out that she was having an abortion.
Elizabeth.
You should go. John, I'm done. Just go, please.
and that was the end of the marriage, which left him devastated.
Sorely wounded by my marriage, I cried inside. For a while, I avoided companions and kept to myself, trying to regain my balance and self-respect.
John had a lot of women in his life, and I don't think he was just philandering as much as he was searching, I think. I think he needed a woman to lift him up. His mother had not done that. Was he looking for a mother in women? Maybe. I think that's what he was doing. That's how I would analyze it.
John had the opportunity to be in a film with Zazu Pitts. People know Zazu Pitts as a comedian. She was a quirky-looking woman and with a strange voice, but she was actually a very serious actress.
In the story, the heroine was really upset about a relationship, so she was going to jump into these rapids down below and kill herself. They asked John to do the stunt.
We were on location in Northern California on the Feather River. This was a mean and roaring river, frigid from the mountain snow melt of the Sierra Nevadas.
The jump is one thing. Then your landing in the river is another. There are rocks in the river, there's a current. But this is another problem. He had to wear a full dress and a hat and a wig to do this jump. That could be very dangerous as well. It could get entangled. Anything could happen.
This is a highly dangerous stunt.
Okay, John, aim for my signal. Get ready to jump. Stand by, John.
At once, I was sucked into the cascading stream.
I think once he hit the water and the current took him, he's struggling, gasping for air. So he's doing his best to, you know, survive at that point.
He's barely making it. He's almost drowning.
A mile down the river, he's able to pull himself to safety.
When they pulled him out, they tried to ask him.
You okay?
Yeah, I think so.
All right, good job. Moving on.
Once he said he's okay and everything, they just went on to the next thing like nothing had happened. This is the life of a stuntman. Thank you very much, but, you know, let's move on. We don't really give a damn.
I lay there panting and thought how paradoxical it is that man, who lives in continual fear of hunger, disease, ignorance, poverty, and death, struggles to stretch out the time allotted him.
I think with a stunt like that, when you're that close to death's door, it makes you reevaluate everything.
The epiphany was, what am I going to do with my life?
I climbed out of that frigid river with too many questions. Where do I go from here? More of this or something else? I wish I had the clarity of purpose and direction that I saw in others, like the young aspiring actor that I befriended in my apartment building.
How do I look?
Like a fool.
You're just jealous because I get more ladies.
You sure the movies are for you? I mean, your name, Clark, it's sort of namey pamey for a marquee.
No, it's not.
Yeah, and your ears, they stick out too far. They're way too big for your head.
Hey, do my ears stick out too far?
No, they look just fine. Okay, let's get you in front of the backdrop.
Clark Gable, who at that point was a dress extra, which meant that he had his own tuxedo, and so therefore he could appear in these costume films, and he got paid twice what an extra would make normally.
Oh, yeah?
They hit it off as friends.
Clark Gable was like John. Both of them wanted to break into the film industry. But you see, Clark was very much focused on being an actor, but John wasn't. John didn't particularly want to be an actor. John was waffling, what am I going to do kind of a thing. He saw what you have to do to begin this business and looked at Gable and sort of gave him his advice.
I think the place for you is the theater. Movies are too phony. There's no way you're ever going to become a movie star.
So this was the advice that, of course, that was given to someone who became one of the greatest actors on film of all time.
I admired Gable for laughing away my suggestions and sticking with his passion. In return for my useless guidance, he gave me something useful, the kick in the pants to pursue my dream.
When you're in Hollywood, part of your life experience as being in the film industry is the social life, the Hollywood colony. You have to meet everyone, the publicists, the writers, the actresses, the actors, the producers, directors. You have to network among all these people.
So at one point he finds himself at a party at the Beverly Hills home of Marion Davies, who was the common law wife of William Randolph Hearst, the most powerful publisher in the world. At that party was Luella Parsons, who was also a very, very powerful columnist who could make or break careers in Hollywood.
You, sir, are either an actor, I don't know, or a young man who should be an actor.
No, ma'am, I'm not an actor.
Well, why not? You're handsome enough for it. You do know who I am.
Yes, I do. I read your column.
Luella Parsons says, I can get you a screen test at MGM. You know, you'll get paid $75 per week, a 7-year contract.
I am very flattered, but...
He just resisted this and decided to ask her for something else.
What I really want to do is write, like you do.
To be a reporter, to write for maybe a newspaper, because she was connected to the Hearst newspapers.
Telephone this number.
And she did get him a job. He left Hollywood and went to New York. He made the right choice, and Gable made his choice. Gable was angry at him for not taking the MGM job. He wanted that job. But it's obvious that John didn't want that.
Thank you, Ms. Parsons.
John had an incredible sense inside himself of what he was looking for. So even though all of these things were exciting and glamorous, it didn't seduce him. It didn't take him off track.
Well, with Luella Parsons' recommendation, he was offered a job in New York at one of Hearst newspaper and started there at $25 a week as a cub reporter.
When John did something, he committed to it.
And I think that's what he did when he went to New York. He listened to those who had been doing it for a long time and had the sense that I could then do that.
The center of journalism in the United States was New York, not Washington, D.C. Washington, D.C. at that time was a swampy capital that no one wanted to have anything to do with. The center of the United States when it came to entertainment, theater, banking, newspapers was New York. So if you wanted a job that involved writing, and you wanted to be at the center of the action, well, was on the right path to come to New York in the 1920s, because that's when newspapers were thriving. It was the job to have for an aspiring writer.
It was hard for me to believe that here I finally was, a country boy who went to Hollywood, became a stuntman, and now at a desk in the big city newspaper, the New York American.
I don't know what you get from falling off a building. It seems terrifying to me. But the adrenaline rush that you get as a journalist, even today, is what attracts many people out to that. First of all, you get to be a witness. You get to be a witness to the greatest human dramas, murder, politics, scandals, corruption. I mean, you're right there seeing these things unfold. So if you're interested in humanity, there's no better box seat to the pageantry of life than being a journalist.
I quickly came to learn that pictures were an important ingredient to the paper. A few days into the job, I was sent to Queens to obtain photographs of a woman who'd been murdered in Manhattan. None of my competitors managed to get into her locked apartment, but drawing on my Hollywood derring do, I climbed up the back fire escape and entered through an unlocked window and snagged some framed photos off the victim's dresser.
There's enormous pressure on a young man entering a newspaper like that to have a scoop. Because if you had a scoop, it had economic consequences for the newspaper, because for that next hour, you dominated the sales. After that, the other paper could and did steal your story and reproduce it.
Nice work, Wells. Don't know how you do it. Probably don't want it, but keep it up.
Okay.
The next edition of The American was the only paper in New York that printed the picture of the deceased and her family. Thereafter, whenever there were pictures to be procured, I was sent to get them.
So Weld got things that no one else had that mattered when news was competitive.
Mostly my assignments as a cub reporter for the next few months were interviewing celebrities and reporting their scandalous activities and marital troubles.
And they were definitely involved.
It's an intoxicating, vivacious, exciting world for a young man with writing aspirations. For somebody like John Weld to arrive in a newsroom in New York at that time, it was noisy. It was using all the latest technology. They had telephones. They had reporters on beat systems calling in stories.
As a cub reporter, I saw so much of death that I should have come to understand it. I covered tragedies, victims of accidents, the murdered, and those who had died by their own hands.
Today, in the 21st century, if we want news, we turn to CNN or something like that's constantly updated. That was the internet. That was the CNN of that time, where these hourly papers that were published and on the streets sold by those newsies as boys who hawked the papers. And so the big events of that town were chronicled not in a lazy 24-hour news cycle, but were chronicled instantly as they happened.
Now and then, I wrote a feature story, such as an old woman who was evicted because she kept a house full of cats. These early stories were heavily rewritten by the editors. Within a year, my authorship actually appeared much as I had written it. I was becoming a writer.
In the 1920s, if you aspired to be a writer, Paris was the Mecca. That's the place you wanted to be. And there were a lot of reasons for it. So to start with, if you were a person who had very little money, that's a writer by definition, Paris would be the perfect place to go. For a few dollars, you could get a walk-up flat on the left bank, surrounded by inspiring artists of all sorts. And for a couple more bucks, you could drink all day in a cafe while drinking was outlawed in the United States. And also it offered sexuality of a kind that America didn't. I mean, America was just a very puritanical country in the 20s. And Paris offered a kind of liberation that was, for somebody like Weld, probably a perfect place to go.
This was the period of time when Lindbergh made his famous flight to Paris. And he had got a great opportunity to go to Paris to report on this great flight.
By then, Lindbergh madness was at its height. My job was to follow him and note down every word he uttered, no matter how banal. I reported everything he ate, how he liked his eggs, if he used cream in his coffee or lemon in his tea.
Didn't matter, you know, how mundane, they would write it down and then report it so it could be, you know, broadcast out on the newspaper. And that was kind of his start in Paris.
When Lindbergh returned to the United States, I decided I'd stay put. If I was going to become a real writer, then Paris is where I needed to be.
He knew nobody, and he trusted that this was the opportunity to learn to write, to make connections with people. He was completely immersed in, how do I learn? How do I refine my craft? How do I develop my soul as a writer? How do I develop my skills as a writer?
The sidewalk cafes alone are worth the expense of crossing the Atlantic. There are theaters in which you can sit for hours sipping liquids and watching the drama of life.
So Weld, as a stringer in Paris needing a job, was attracted by the fact that Paris had a daily English-speaking English newspaper, the Paris Herald Tribune. And that's where a lot of writers ended up getting their money from while he engaged in creative writing at night. It's also very important. I mean, anyone who came into Paris, first thing you would do would be pick up a copy of the Herald Tribune to see what had happened.
The fabulous 20s was an era of literary hijinks and wonderful nonsense. And the Paris edition of the New York Herald Tribune was its chronicler.
One of the advantages for Weld being a reporter for the Paris Herald and being in Paris is that it was a destination of choice for many famous Americans. So in the course of a week, you know, people like Franklin Delano Roosevelt, who was then governor of the state of New York, would have come to Paris, or other famous people. So for somebody like Weld, he would have had contact with all of these luminaries easily, and they would have had to pay attention to him because he was from the press. So as part of his daily work for the Paris Herald Tribune, it would have been normal for an editor to say, look who's coming to town next week is Franklin Delano Roosevelt. You need to cover him.
As I came up, his son James was escorting him into the hotel. Roosevelt greeted me graciously and answered questions as I strolled alongside.
Governor, any comment on the rumor you're running for president?
Young man, I can't run.
That's not true. If they want him to run, he'll run.
Pay no attention to him. He's my son.
Yeah, well, it's a good quote.
Well, then quote him, not me.
Thank you.
A newspaper like the Paris Herald was a one-stop entertainment machine. It carried a wire copy with news from back home and international news. And perhaps most important for a lot of people, it contained gossip. And so when Weld walked into the newsroom, if there was a name he might have known in the newsroom from reading the paper, it would have been Sparrow Robinson.
Sparrow wrote a column called Sporting Gossip that was precisely that, a record of his daily and nightly wanderings and the persons he met and their chit-chat. It was the most popular feature in the paper. He was a heavy drinker, and the alcohol seemed to bring out the best in him.
Paris was a community open to somebody like John Wayne, but his trump card was, of course, he had an introduction as a reporter for the Paris Herald, being accompanied by Sparrow Robinson. He would have met anybody that was important in the creative world of Paris. It was an intoxicating moment for a young man like Weld with writing aspirations.
Paris was really the dazzling place in Europe for writers and artists and anybody connected with the arts. Picasso was there, Hemingway, Eugene O'Neill, Ford, Maddox Ford, they were all there.
John Weld, a man in his 20s in Paris, was in the catbird seat. I mean, he would have had access to everyone that we now venerate. Sparrow Robinson would have been the key to an introduction to some of these people.
Sparrow, you old dog, you. I see you casting an eye my way and scribbling furiously.
She's just a distant niece, nothing more.
Of course, Ethan, nothing more.
And who might this be?
This is John Weld.
Pleasure.
He's with the Herald. I'm giving him the lay of the land.
How Sparrow managed to make this pilgrimage 5 nights a week and stay alive is one of the great human mysteries. We all marveled at his durability.
For an aspiring writer like Weld, the opportunity to meet successful writers, writers that were on the cutting edge of literature at that point, would have been frequent in Paris. There were a number of opportunities.
Le Café Dôme became my sitting room, dining room, and bar, as familiar to me as my office at the Herald. James Joyce came to the Dome. He was slight, handsome, wore a small Van Dyke beard, and seemed unusually timid.
Mr. Weld, you're back.
Mind if I join you again? If it's not too much distraction.
I sat with him whenever I could, and in time, he became comfortable with me.
Looks like you've had a long day.
Ugh.
The ability to ask the creator why they did something makes a huge difference and would have an enormous influence on Weld's sense of writing.
It was women. And your exploits with them.
Yeah, I'm just trying to find the right one, I guess.
Women will give you the shirts off their backs, and gladly. Consider my wife. I sit and write. She sees me as an artist, thinks I need time to create.
It's a pleasure to talk with him. I always come away feeling encouraged. I told him I was having a hard time finding a publisher for my novel, and he said that he had always had difficulty getting his work published.
So I just need to find the right woman to get published?
It wouldn't hurt. The perseverance is the key. Don't ever stop writing, pushing.
One of the great takeaways that John had with hanging out with James Joyce was that even though he was a reporter, he didn't feel less than. He didn't feel like, oh, you know, I'm in the presence of this great writer and I'm just a, you know, I'm a nothing. He felt like, I'm a reporter, and I'm moving toward what I want to do.
Yeah, John was actually working on two books while in Paris. One was Gun Girl, which was about a very pretty Italian young girl of 18 who became a drug addict, robbed cigar stores, and ended up killing a policeman and went to the electric chair. The second one was Stuntman, which was about John's early life as a stuntman in Hollywood.
And he had an incredible opportunity with James Joyce. And James Joyce made such a difference to him because he said two things, tenacity, tenacity, tenacity. You know, the truth is, to be a writer, you've got to write and write and write. And he said, scrounge around. You know, it was, he was really saying, don't worry if you're not making money at it right now. Take this job, take that job, but don't give up on the writing. And that was one of the most valuable things he learned from anybody in his, in really in his whole life.
On one of his reporting jobs, John met a very attractive young woman, Patricia Warrington, who happened to be in Paris with her mother. She was engaged and waiting to be married to a Count Charles de Roussel.
John and Patricia seemed to hit it off, and they took up a little dalliance.
And how goes matrimony?
Oh, getting used to it.
I don't get it. You are beautiful, young, rich, intelligent, and give yourself up to some old fogey for a silly title?
Patricia ended up marrying the Count, but that did not end their liaisons.
It's a very real title, I assure you.
Yeah, well, how is he in bed?
Oh.
She would tell her husband, Count, who was not a real attractive fellow, but anyway, she'd tell him, I'm going to go to my art class. So instead of going to art class, she'd go over to John's.
And the Count has her followed by a private detective, and one day they knock on the door.
Come in.
And there she is, having tea with John.
You're just in time for some tea.
Is this your art school?
I've just come from there.
You've done nothing of the sort. My private detective followed you here and notified me immediately. What are you doing here?
Really, Charles, we were just having tea.
Anyway, the Count knew that was just baloney.
You, sir, have humiliated me. I challenge you to a duel. You will be at Porta de Luya Saturday at dawn. I will bring the blades. Come along, Patricia.
The Count is challenging me to a duel with foils. A sword fight, so he can defend his wife's honor. On Saturday at dawn, I am to show up at the Porte d'Auteuil and bring a second, a friend, in case I'm perforated. My first reaction was that it sounded like a joke. He couldn't be serious. One of us could get hurt.
The first man yields, or is otherwise intent.
Okay. He picked Sparrow Roberts to be his second.
Good luck, kid. Away they went, back and forth, back and forth.
The Count had no idea that I'd trained with foils during my stunt days.
I think Sparrow the whole time was saying, you know, this isn't for real. You really, you guys don't have to do this.
You can quit whenever you'd like. Not until you are beaten.
And it turned out that they were fairly evenly matched.
Finally, you know, the Count was just all worn out because he was not a young man, so to speak. So Sparrow stepped in and said,
come on, fellas, stop this foolishness. Let's go get a drink.
Is that it? My honor is satisfied.
Permit me to apologize for offending you.
So the Count asks,
where did you learn to fence?
And he says, well, you know, I was a stuntman in Hollywood, and it was John Barrymore that taught me how to do this.
You surprised me, sir.
The whole episode was ludicrous, and it ended my brief affair with Patricia.
John always looked at this time of life for women who were, I would say, his equal, who were very smart, bright individuals that, you know, he could talk to and enjoy a conversation.
He met this woman, Nan Sutherland, who was sort of there in a holding pattern because she was engaged to be married to Walter Houston, the actor, who was in the process of trying to get a divorce so they could be married.
Nan Sutherland had been an accomplished stage actress in New York and was also working in Hollywood and ended up in Paris at a party.
Well, they hit it off and so forth, and both being in their 20s. John offered to escort her back to her hotel because, you know, she was there by herself.
Nan, to my utter surprise, turned my face with her hands and kissed me on the lips.
That's for taking me home.
But one kiss deserves another.
I was elated and emboldened. We kissed again.
John could be very charming, and evidently they became very close.
But there was a fervent, intoxicating magnetism between us.
You'll need a proper escort. I hereby volunteer.
That sounds lovely, Mr. Weld.
She received word, a wire from Walter Houston saying, the coast is now clear. Come on back to New York.
Should I call you a taxi, madam?
Yes, thank you.
Should I see you to the depot?
It's best we say our goodbyes here.
Bye for now.
We kissed goodbye, lovers no longer. She said to me,
this isn't the end of our friendship. You're gonna sell your book to the movies and come to Hollywood. Mark my words.
It was a few days after Nan had left, John received word that McBride, the publisher in New York, had picked up his book, The Stuntman, and they sent him a $300 advance check. So he had money now to come back to the U.S.
When a book is published, there's some publicity. And Columbia Pictures decided possibly to buy this story, this book, and maybe make a film out of it. They do offer him $250 a week to come to Hollywood and to write a screenplay relating to this book. He comes back. He was given a little office space in a special writer's patio, they called it.
There's nothing like favorable publicity to raise one's standing in a community. Suddenly, I was a person of repute.
He was in one of these little cubicles writing this screenplay, which then they decided we should make this a screenplay about a stunt woman instead of a stunt man. I mean, this went on back and forth.
After a month, he turned in his outline with all the suggestions. They didn't like it, and he was fired off his own project.
He was very disappointed, but there wasn't anything he can do about it. That's the way the game was played in Hollywood in those days. So he just accepted it and moved on.
When John came to Hollywood, he reconnected with Nan, who was now married to the actor Walter Huston.
Through Nan, I got to know Walter better. There was an affinity between Walter and me, and we quickly became friends.
I've heard many, many stories of their comings and goings, and they really believed in John.
He is in the Hollywood social scene. He's popular for being an author and having worked in Hollywood as a stuntman, and so he really gets to know a lot of people, and he knew how to party. So he fit in with this crowd. And he was a very charming man, so he kept getting invited to parties. Eventually, he meets this woman by the name of Pancho Barnes, who could out-party anybody.
She was the most untraditional woman I'd ever known. Stocky, with a hearty laugh. She dressed like a man, drank like a man, and played hard at everything she endeavored. Character-wise, she was an iconoclast, nonconformist, a rebel.
Pancho Barnes was a very famous aviatrix. She had the fastest plane in the world. She also flew stunts for the movies in her planes and organized the first union in Hollywood for stunt pilots. And so she and John Weld connected right away from that background. And they got off famously right off the bat.
He got invited to a party at Pancho Barnes' house down in Laguna Beach. In fact, it was said John was one of the few people who liked to party as much as Pancho did.
One of the great things about her parties, she was well known for having the best liquor around, and it was prohibition. By the way, she was married to an Episcopal priest at this time.
Shortly after being greeted by Pancho, I met a couple I did not know.
Hey, Dylan, Gigi. Hey, you remember Amo?
Gigi and Dilwyn Parrish. At first sight of Gigi, something went kerplunk in my psyche.
And this is John Weld. He's quite the stuntman.
I was startled by her beauty. She embodied the woman of my fantasies.
Hey, Dylan, come on, let's grab some more hooch.
For me, it was admiration, lust, and acquisitiveness at first sight. Suddenly, I was face to face with the most desirable woman I had ever seen.
A spark was lit that night, I think. Though I don't know if Gigi was totally aware of it yet.
For me to covet Gigi was nonsensical, even idiotic. I had little to offer the beautiful young actress save a song and a loving heart.
I must say, Mrs. Parrish, you will no doubt light up the silver screen. I will myself be first in line on the opening night of your first starring role.
Why, Mr. Weld, I imagine you meet a great many starlets in your line of work. And I'd wager you say that to all of them.
A few.
Over and above that impediment, she was married, had a good job, and was on her way to becoming a celebrity.
In all sincerity, Mrs. Parrish, none as captivating as yourself.
She got married when she was 16 to a gentleman, Dilwyn Parrish, and she had this desire to get out to Hollywood. She had grown up seeing the movies, so she ventured out on a Harley Davidson with Dilwyn and went across country. He could tell when he met her right from the beginning that this is not an ordinary gal, even though it was a brief meeting at Pancho's house.
When John's mom set him free, she'd planted the seeds that there was a sense of a destiny, and part of that destiny was that there was a woman who he was gonna join with. And so as he moved through these experiences, they were very me experiences, but what happened when he finally saw the woman that he was destined to be with, his world changed. He felt suddenly that now my dream is to be an us.
I hope Mr. Weld was able to keep you entertained in my absence.
Oh, John's an entertaining fellow.
He is indeed. He's been sharing some of the highlights of his stunt career. Quite exhilarating.
Nothing more than an honest day's work, I assure you.
At this time, my life's tide had fallen to its lowest ebb. I couldn't be with Gigi, and I had no job. I wrote to the city editor at the New York American as a friend in need and told him my tale of woe. He promptly offered me a reporter's wage, so I headed back to New York.
Back in John's stuntman days, he had a job up in Northern California. And I was sitting around one time with one of the crewmen. They were talking about the Donner Party and what transpired. And John filed that away, saying, "That's a fascinating story. It'd be great to maybe write a book on that."
I was going to work on the American, but that is not where I wanted to spend my life. The compulsion to write books was still in me, and the story of the Donner Party would be my next venture.
It was in April 1846 that some American pioneers, which were migrating to California, left Independence, Missouri, heading for California. And what happened between November and February 18th, they got caught in the worst snowstorm in history. And the snow reached 22 feet high. They quickly ran out of food, and they finally resorted to cannibals because they were dying.
John heads off to New York, and Gigi is in Hollywood working in the studios. Her first movie was Roman Scandal. And when it played in New York, John was in the front row to watch it.
By 1935, I had spent 2 years splitting my life between reporting for the paper and writing the Donner book. It was time to focus solely on the book. So I quit the newspaper and decided to head back west to continue my research at the Bancroft Library in Northern California.
John wired Gigi and Dilwyn that he was coming out to California. So they invited him to dinner, so he swung by there before he headed north.
In the taxi carrying me to their home, I was troubled about the ethics of what I was doing. Coveting another man's wife breaks the 10th commandment, and according to law, Gigi belonged to Dilwyn.
Welcome home. I'm so glad that you let us know that you'd be in town.
He was very happy to see her again.
Pleasure is assuredly all mine.
And I'm sure she was very happy to see him again.
Thank you.
The penitent returns.
Ah, Dilwyn.
Welcome.
Thank you.
Won't you come in?
Of course.
But that was where I believe that Gigi knew that there was something in her heart for John.
So this book, it's based on a true life story?
Yes, about the Donner Party. There's a great deal of research material up at the Berkeley Library, so I'm headed there tomorrow. I just thought I'd stop in on friends since I was out here on the West Coast.
I'm glad you could fit us in.
And how has your career been progressing? I did get to see Roman Scandal in New York.
Oh, that was a wonderful experience. I just did a picture with John Barrymore and Carol Lombard called 20th Century. I play Barrymore's secretary.
Barrymore has quite the reputation. Did he try to seduce you?
No such luck. Dilwyn was there to protect me.
But that cat of a director, Howard Hawks, he tried to seduce her, invited her back to his house for dinner, offered her a long-term contract at Columbia.
You're being dramatic. I went for a dinner party only to discover that I was the only guest. And when he found out that I was married, well, the evening ended abruptly.
We need another bottle. I shall be right back.
So he finally confessed to her that he really came back.
Just to see you.
I was wondering if you were ever coming back. No, John, I can't.
Why not? She, of course, said, well, I'm married.
I can't leave Dilwyn. He needs me. And there's my career. I won't give that up.
I'll support it. I'll get a real job.
I think she had warmed up to John by that time.
It is so wonderful seeing you again, John.
It has indeed been wonderful. But I must be headed back to the Knickerbocker. I have an early train.
Well, let me give you a lift back to your hotel.
That'd be fine, thank you.
And he went up Northern California to research his book.
About a month after John was in San Francisco, he got a letter from he's saying that she and Dilwyn were divorcing. He had called her immediately and he said, I'll be right there.
Dilwyn had actually fallen in love himself with another woman. So I think they both decided that it was, you know, probably divorce was the better way to go. So that marriage ended, and of course that was a delight for John.
To me, you are the most beautiful, marvelous, and darling woman on earth, and I will devote myself to providing, protecting, adoring, and amusing you. Together, we will have a wonderful life.
Gigi was not ready to commit. She loved John very much, but she was not ready to commit, and she truly was an independent woman.
For the first time in my life, I'm an independent person. To me, it's a fantastic experience, and at least for a while, I don't want to be beholden.
She said, well, wait a second. I'd like to have a little time, because she'd never had any time by herself. She married at 16, and she has a good job. So she figured, I want to be on my own for a year while I'm getting a divorce, and then we'll take up after we get the divorce.
Gigi was everything that John wanted in a woman, perhaps had been looking for in all the women that he had been with. She was strong and confident, absolutely beautiful.
I believe that Gigi loved him for him, not for what he might do for her or for any other reason. And I believe that that confidence for both of them was there. They both came from similar backgrounds, different stories, but similar backgrounds. And they came together and lifted one another up in a beautiful way. Once John and Gigi started their relationship, John came to her and said,
Gigi isn't the name for someone so beautiful. You should have more than some childhood nickname.
I'm used to it. It's mine.
And so he wanted her to change her name to Katie, which was a shortened version of her middle name, Catherine.
Katie. It's a strong name. If it's all right with you, can I call you Katie?
If that's what you want, then I'm fine with that.
Let's let Hollywood and the world still love you as Gigi. But Katie will be the one part of you that's mine. I'll never ask you to change anything else.
From that point forward, she was Katie.
They were like two free spirits who found each other and became like one delicious whole soul.
I continued polishing my book. In the meantime, as Katie awaited her divorce to become final, her career blossomed.
She became voted in as a Wampus baby star. Wampus was an advertising campaign for the film industry in which they would find or discover young girls for the film industry and make them stars. Starlets, I should say.
To help cover expenses, my dear friend Walter Houston and his wife Nan offered me work as an assistant. I could manage Walter's film and theater work and still have time for my book. When Walter accepted the role of Othello on Broadway, he asked me to join him in New York. I told Katie that I'd be leaving her for a long time.
Katie had to make a decision to follow John to New York or not when the Houstons moved there. And John was wanting to get married. And Katie was not quite there yet.
I thought about my future. What am I going to do with my life? Am I going to stay in Hollywood and hope to make it in the movies? Or am I going to get away and find a happier life?
She decided that becoming married to John Weld was really how she saw her future. So when John said that he was going to go with Nan and Walter to New York, Katie decided that she's going to commit to John now as good a time as any.
Well, Katie and John, when she decided to go with him, they took a car trip across country in her convertible in their little summer outfits when they were off on an adventure. Well, somewhere in Wyoming, it started snowing. And then a blizzard came along. And here they are in this California car, their California outfits.
I rarely turned off the engine for fear it would freeze.
Keeping my feet.
My feet became so numb, Katie removed my shoes and rubbed my feet between her hands.
Is that better?
A little.
The irony that we were suffering a bit like the Donner Party was not lost on us.
This is exactly what happened to the Donner Party. And in late September, too. It's just like us.
Well, that didn't turn out so well for them.
Hey, well, 48 of 87 survived.
By eating each other. You know, if you needed to eat me, John, to survive, I'd be okay with that.
Nonsense. We have 100 horses to pull us through.
Unless the horses run out of gas.
John always said if they could live through that, he felt pretty secure in them making a life together.
We reached New York, and my first mission was to introduce Katie to my mother. Like me, mother had followed her stars to the big city.
John's mother, Debbie Lewis, was a very well-known astrologer. In fact, she was Nancy Reagan's astrologer at one point. And Debbie had done their charts. And she was very happy with the results that she found.
Having been born on opposite sides of the zodiac, you're very well balanced.
And because you've both been married, you should know what you're getting yourselves into. You each need an anchor. And remember that marriage is a union of concordance and mutual esteem, loyalty and steadfastness.
A mother's blessing and the affirmation of the firmament were the finest endorsements we could hope for. My next stop in New York was with a book editor at Scribner's Publishing.
Scribner's was the publisher for some of the greatest names in writing at that time. And if he could be on their list of writers, that was something special.
They're the ones that put Hemingway, F. Scott Fitzgerald, Thomas Wolfe on the map. So he met with Max Perkins, and he liked what he heard about the Donner Party. So he said, yeah, get me a manuscript, and we'll see what we can do. That was a big win.
I think John would tell you, you know, you have to make your mark. And in his mind, this was making his mark. And also fulfilled Brown's, you know, vision. Someday he would do something important.
News from my friend Walter was not as uplifting. His play closed after a few weeks. So Katie and I started our drive back to California, still with fingers crossed that Perkins would accept and publish my manuscript, and keeping an eye peeled for the right place to get married. As we headed west, it occurred to us that Phoenix was a singularly appropriate place for our nuptials. We had both risen from the emotional ashes of other marriages. We found a judge to perform the ceremony, toasted our wedlock with Coca-Colas, and lit out for home.
When they got back home, they received word from Max Perkins.
From Scribner's.
Open it.
Dear Mr. Weld, thank you for sending along the manuscript for Don't You Cry For Me. All of us here at Scribner's are excited by the work and eager to publish it.
He really liked the manuscript. Thought it would be a great book.
Contracts in advance to follow. Sincerely, Max Perkins.
And it really put John on the map as far as being a literary figure.
This is it. I'm going to be published by Scribner.
How mysterious and fragile are destiny's doings. What happened over 100 years ago would seem to have no bearing on what happened today. And yet the Donner Party incident changed the course of my life.
John's book, Don't You Cry For Me, was a big hit. And it was on the New York bestsellers list.
He felt that now I am a writer. You know, I'm going to be able to go on from here and write. This is where he had tried to go for a long time, to be a well-received writer. Not just to be a writer, but one that was well-received and had the accolades.
Suddenly, we were celebrated. Friends lauded me. People I barely knew telephoned to congratulate me. But then came the most heartbreaking news for Katie and me.
When Katie and John found out about the fibroid tumors, it was devastating to both of them, especially to Katie. She wanted children. She wanted to give John children.
I'm so sorry.
What? No. No.
I'm depriving you of being a father.
I have you. You are my child and I am yours. We don't need children. We have each other.
I don't remember a day so fraught with sorrow.
Katie's inability to have children at first was a shock for them. But rather than living as if it were a loss, they reframed it.
It took them in a whole other direction because they knew now that there wasn't going to be family.
It really was another example of how John embraced what life presented. You know, it wasn't a loss. It was an opportunity to create a whole new adventure.
John and Katie came to Laguna Beach, and they bought a fixer-upper on the cliffs in South Laguna called Pelican Perch. I'll never forget that home. It was a beautiful home. Very simple, but very beautiful. And the view was unbelievable.
We were going to make the home our own, a place from which we did not have to move. A shelter from storms and a haven from adversity. A place where Katie could reign and embellish, where I could work and we could play.
They loved that house from the time they moved into it. They worked hard on it. They did a lot of the work themselves. And they made a home.
They were very happy people. They were very active. They were very athletic. A lot of swimming. They loved to go for their morning and afternoon swim. There was always people, every day. We were either visiting somebody when I was staying with them or somebody was visiting them. I say they're into health foods and that they did have their cocktail hour. They love those martinis and they enjoy them with friends.
During World War II, I put my writing skills to use as a public relations manager for an aircraft company. After the war, I worked in the marketing department for the Ford Motor Company. Then I founded our hometown newspaper, the Laguna Beach Post.
He continued to write, but they always felt they could do more. You know, they had two people who had worked in or behind the cameras that knew how to write and loved to travel and were adventuresome. They did put it together and they started doing travel logs, traveling to exotic places around the world.
Katie and I could travel and we'd film our journey and share the documentary with whoever would watch.
He and Katie had never had a honeymoon, so we decided we'll go around the world and we'll shoot a documentary of our trip.
We would circumnavigate the globe on freighters and visit exotic ports of call. To begin the trip, I had arranged for a cabin on a Danish freighter leaving California bound for Asia. About 30 crew and only 6 passengers.
I remember when they were going off on their first trip, there was a party and lots of excitement and joy around it.
In January 1961, they boarded the ship, the Laosk-Maersk, out of San Pedro, heading for Japan. That was the first leg of their trip.
John started filming from the very moment they got on board. He had the cameras rolling, and every day he was shooting film of the voyage.
When they were about 17 miles out of Yokohama, John and Katie were enjoying the evening with friends.
Well, I'm just happy we got through those storms.
It was rather a wonderful adventure. I got some marvelous shots.
You would have damn well end up in the Pacific if I hadn't had you on a rope.
You mustn't forget, John's a daredevil. The intrepid stuntman. Mm.
And there was a loud noise, a very loud noise.
There was a horrendous sound of crunching steel, and the ship shuddered. For a moment, all was still and quiet. Within seconds came the piercing sound of mouth-blown whistles and crewmen yelling.
Everyone on deck, and grab your life jackets. This is not a drill.
Hey, what's happening?
We've struck another ship. Hurry.
What had happened was another ship,
Mayday, Mayday.
Cargo ship, had come in, and it was foggy. It was very foggy, and hit this cargo ship. It was devastating.
Lifeboats, let's go.
The ship is
going to
turn over.
We still have time. Hey, look, see the lights? Yokohama. Help is on the way, no doubt.
Water's coming in, everybody's panicking and freaking out. As they're about to jump off the ship into the water, he realizes
the film. My camera, I have to go.
Hey, don't leave me.
I forgot the footage.
I'll be right back, I promise. Victor, take her with you.
No, John.
She's like, I'll be right back. She's like,
don't leave me. Katie, John.
Katie, we have to go.
John.
We have to go now.
Katie.
He risks his own life, goes back to get his film stock.
And John has to make a crucial decision. Either he lets go of his camera equipment and film and tries to escape the rushing water coming in, or he's going to end up going down with the ship.
In the split second before the sea swallowed me, I took a deep breath. All I could inhale, well aware that it might be my last. Suddenly, something uncommon occurred. One moment I had been clinging maniacally to life, and in a split second was welcoming death as a long-sought friend. I thought that man goes through life concerned with oncoming time, and suddenly it occurred to me that I had no future. It was a glorious feeling. I was truly free.
When you drowned, you had this sense of euphoria, and you just kind of let everything go. And he actually went through that process thinking, this is it.
Having accepted death, I ran through the pattern of my life. From my mother, I had learned the value of independence. From James Joyce, I had learned tenacity and how to scrounge. From Pancho Barnes, I learned a love for adventure. From Clark Gable, I learned to never give up on my dreams. But my outstanding stroke of good fortune had been latching onto Katie. From her, I learned fidelity. She had encouraged me and had followed me courageously.
He was recounting his entire life, what he learned, what the messages were, what the lessons were. He's having the biggest epiphany of his entire life, that life is so precious, that love means everything. Love is the most important thing a person can have in their life. And in that moment, he fought like hell to live, and he fought like hell to love.
Katie, in the meantime, crewman had pulled her onto a life raft. So of course, she's yelling for John. So when she jumped in, tried again, they pulled her back.
And she was terrified that he was killed.
John!
John! Next thing you know, boom, he hits that surface, and he survived.
Oh my God! John!
Come on, swim this way! Come on, come on! Hurry!
John!
Reach out, reach out, reach out, reach out! Good! That's great, right here!
John!
Come on, up, 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 up!
I'm sure his wife was pretty upset that he risked his own neck for his film, but once a stuntman, you're always a stuntman.
Experience that took them to the depths of their souls and almost took their lives. And it did take a few people's lives.
I was wondering if you were ever coming back.
I think the story of John Weld is really a story about self-discovery, self-actualization.
You're talking about a person that was fearless, charmed, had honor and integrity.
He's really a Renaissance person. He did a little bit of everything and apparently did it really well.
He was one of these people who made up the rules as you went along.
John had a love for life as much or more than anybody I ever met.
We were always amazed that he could make a living and seem like he had a lot of free time.
They loved each other so deeply and had come to such an incredible place in their lives together. It was true love to the very end for those two.
What has life taught me? That we can't control it, that we are simply guided by fate and can only control how we respond. And I've learned Katie Weld is the key to my joy and delight. The sinking of that freighter solidified our union. That brush with death made us realize the fragility and brevity of life and how much we needed each other.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm.